You're watching the free version of Silhouette Essentials. For projects and footage, head to BorisFX.com for the premium download.
Welcome to Class 4, Part 1. It's all about marker removal. In this clip, we have a dancer on a green screen with markers, tape pieces, and targets. The task is to remove the markers, pieces of tape, and targets on the walls and the floor to help with the extraction. I will also make a G-mat around the character so that way not all of the markers, etc. have to be removed. The areas below the shadows also need to be cleaned. If they are preserved, then the compositor can use them down the line for the shot. So I'll add a note to the session with the frame range and what has to be done. And I've already denoised the footage in a different session, so that step is complete. I'll play the shot so we can analyze it and we'll talk about shot approach. The techniques I will use will be in paint with tracking and some manual and procedural paint touch-ups. In the past, I would have utilized auto paint with cloning for the majority of the work, but the newer Inpaint node allows for a faster way and makes quick work of markers. But the frames where the markers intersect with the character will need some hand paint. And the shadow areas on the ground will be a bit challenging as well. I have my final node tree here. The sequence has already been previously degrained, and that source is at the top of the tree. So there was my denoise session there, and now I'm in the O2 denoise paint. I did the roto first, so I just have to focus on the areas inside the G-mat. I'm going to use the Inpaint node to fill marker G-mats that also have tracking applied to them. And then I'll do any paint touch-ups in the paint node. If it's hooked up here, it can utilize the tracking in the roto node, and I can also move the input up to the Inpaint node to use the tracking from that node as well. But we're going to just move it back to the roto node. And then I'll do any paint touch-ups in the paint node here. And I just want to have one paint node in general when I set up the node tree. If one has multiple paint nodes and they jump around in between them with painting, then the rebuild process will not be correct if that operation has to be performed. And then down here is where I did a mat operation, and I'll go over that later. And then we have our output node. For the demo in this class, I will make a new node setup off to the side. And I'm going to copy the roto node because I don't want to recreate that during the class. So copy, command, control C, and paste. And we'll just hook that up. Now you can see my roto is here. And then I'm going to also bring in a paint node and hook it up as such. Let's start with InPaint. This node fills a section of an image defined by a shape, thereby removing part of the image that is unwanted. So I'm going to start by making a shape. So I'm going to zoom in here, and we'll just find a section we want to start working on. I'm just going to start from the end of the shot. Okay, so now I can just make a shape. I'm going to click Shift C for the circle shape and just make a circle around this marker. And I can see that it's filled in with the color surrounding the marker. So if I want to just see where the marker was without the infill, I can just press 2, and 2 is foreground. You can see that changes here, and 1 is output. So let's just bring up the node parameters here. Each shape will have its own parameters. It's kind of hard to see here, so I'm just going to undock this and move it up in between the viewer and, here we go, and the trees window. So now we can kind of see some of these parameters a little bit more easily. Just move things around a little bit more. Okay, so here we have our shape in the object list, and you can see that there are lots of options here. So the first thing to think about is the algorithm. So first there is none. And so this is where no algorithms will be applied. And I use this mode when I just want to track things. And then there's the clone. And so the clone just uses the transform parameters to identify a clone source, which is down here. and you can see that this dotted line shows where the clone transform is. So we'll just reset that. And then there are two algorithms that will fill the shapes that you make. One is NS and one is Talea. I'm not sure how you say that. And I usually just stick with NS. This algorithm smoothly propagates colors from the surrounding areas using lines drawn through areas of equal brightness. So let's go back to the output view. I'm going to click one on the keyboard, and it looks like the Inpaint node is functioning as it should. I'll just turn off the overlays by pressing zero, and it's filled in the section where the marker was with green. So if I want to use this for the shot, I'm going to have to track this shape, track the marker. So instead of just changing this back to none, I'm going to change it back to NS, and I'm just going to press two, and I'm going to track in the foreground mode. So we'll go down to the tracker, and I'm going to use the Mocha tracker here. And I'm just going to quickly scrub through and see what the camera move is like. There's a slight push in, but I don't think I need to use scale and rotation. I'm just going to use translation. And we'll just make my shape a tiny bit smaller. So I know the arm kind of gets near this shape for the marker part of the shot, and I don't want it to be thrown off. We can always make our shape bigger after we do the tracking, and then we'll just track. What I really like about InPaint is that the tracking shapes can be used as fill shapes. Okay, now that the track is done, I'm going to press 2 for output. And our markers are moved. So there are a couple things we can do now. I can either keep tracking all the different markers separately, or I can just make a duplication of this layer. So I'm going to just label this layer. I'm going to call it mid marker screen right. And then if I duplicate it, and I'm going to lock the original one, and I'm going to call this upper marker screen right, and just remove the one. And then I'm going to use the multi-frame tool to move up my tracked shape to this marker up here. I'm going to go to the reshape tool here, select my points, click M for the hotkey for a multi-frame. You can see the red border around my image. And I'm just going to move up the shape. Let's just move it as a whole. Okay, then I'm going to disable multi-frame and the red border goes away. And we'll see how that works. There's a little bit of a change with the tracking, and I can just quickly select my shape and nudge it down because I can see part of that marker just coming through on the bottom. Press 0 to see no outlines. And that marker is done as well. So then we have these other markers and things on the screen that intersect with our character. So let's just turn our overlays back on. All I have to do is click the screen with my cursor, and we can decide what to do. Since the marker gets obscured by the character, I can either try to track it till the end, or I can just also duplicate this layer again and see how much usage we can get out of that layer. So I'll just duplicate this first. I'm going to lock this layer, mid marker, duplicate. I'm going to call this mid marker center. I'm going to unlock it. And now I have to transform it over to the center. Click our shape, click M for multi-frame, and we'll just move it over. Click M again to get out of multi-frame. And just see how far that takes us. So anytime you can reuse tracking, just makes the whole process go a little bit faster. But you can see it's now going over the character and causing all these artifacts, and we don't want that. So there's a couple of things we can do. When it gets near to this character, let's just zoom in. I can either start animating the shape so it has less intersections with this side, and then I can just turn it off altogether. So if we get this far and it starts interacting, I'm going to click R for reshape for the point tool. And I like the shape this far. I'm just going to set a keyframe here. And I can do that by pressing down Alt Option in the timeline here. And then if I click in the timeline on the frame I want to be, it sets a keyframe. And then I can animate my shape in a little bit here. Press 0 to see how that's looking. So I'm getting the most out of my tracking and my shape. And then here just might not work very well because I'm going to start interacting too much with the back of the sweatshirt. So what I'm going to do is just I'm going to utilize the tracking as much as possible. And then I'm just going to turn off the shape. So it looks good to about here. And I'm going to set a keyframe and opacity keyframe. So here is my circle. Here's the opacity icon here. I'm going to turn it off and turn it on. Now it's on. And I'm going to go to the next frame and I'm going to disable the opacity. So now my shape is no longer filling in with the surroundings. And then we can just keep going. And then this section here will be hand painted down here in the paint node.